تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَمَن يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا أَمَّا بَعْدُ فَإِنَّ أَصْدَقَ الْحَدِيثِ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد. At the beginning of Revelation, when the Prophet ﷺ became a prophet and he knew he had to deliver this message to the masses, he cried out. I'm sure we're all very familiar with the story. Wa sabaha, woe to a dreadful morning. It's like sounding the alarm. And all the people gathered, all various tribes came together, and he asked, أَرَأَيْتُمْ لَوْ أَخْبَرْتُكُمْ أَنَّ الْعَدُوَ يُسَبِّحُكُمْ أَوْ يُمَسِّيكُمْ أَمَا كُنْتُمْ تُصَدِّقُونِ He said, if I told you that an enemy is going to attack you in the morning or in the evening, would you believe me? And they, of course, said, بَلَا, absolutely, of course. فَإِنِّي نَذِيرٌ لَكُمْ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهَ عَذَابٍ شَدِيدٍ So then he said, I am indeed a warner to you in face of a terrible punishment. And we all know that the moment they understood that this was a religious message about the purpose of life, about the afterlife, about Allah's punishment, the moment that reality settled in, the very first person to react was his own uncle, as we all know, Abu Lahab, who said what? He said, تَفَلَّكْنَا لِهَذَا جَمَعْتَنَا He said, may you be cursed, is this why you gathered us, wasting our time with this nonsense? And because the Prophet is too polite to respond to his uncle in public, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded to him with the ayat of Tabbatida Abi Lahab Mutab. The reason I mention this story is because there is a very valuable lesson in it. Islam began as something controversial. Islam began as something controversial, and it remained controversial. In fact, the Prophet tells us, بَدَأَ الْإِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا وَسَيَعُودُ كَمَا بَدَأَ غَرِيبًا فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَاءِ Islam began as something strange and it will return as it began as something strange. So glad tidings to the stranger. What is this hadith telling you? You have to embrace and accept the fact that our deen is going to make certain people uncomfortable. We're going to have to deal with controversy. We are going to have to address whether it be within ourselves or to the outside world, things that get uncomfortable. Unfortunately, there is this idea among some Muslims. They think to themselves, if I just conform enough, if I just avoid controversies, then finally they'll accept me. Then finally I can go under the radar and just live a peaceful, happy life. Wrong. They'll just move the goalpost and declare new things controversial. That's the way it's going to be. As Allah Ta'ala said, not because I say so, Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَنْ تَرْضَىٰ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَىٰ وَلَنْ نَصَارَىٰ حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ Never will you find that the Jews and the Christians will approve of you until you follow their religion. This is the fact that it doesn't matter where we live, as long as there are disbelievers around us, they will not approve. There will always be certain things that are controversial, that are uncomfortable. And then you have to ask yourself, am I willing to address it? Or will I keep on pretending that they don't exist and try to brush it under the rug? What does this mean that they want you to follow them? Follow could mean they want you to become like them, become Jewish, Christian, whatever the case is. They want you to convert to their religion. But there's another possibility. Another possibility is they want you to follow them, meaning go ahead and remain Muslim. That's fine. But you have to be as malleable as we are. Right? Every other religion, every few years when something new comes up, every other religion conforms. Everybody knows a few years ago, this idea, let's say for example, gay marriage is just a simple example. Everybody said it was declared universally something wrong, and then, oh, now people want it, and so they just go along with it. And the only ones that hold on to their deen are the Muslims. And they say, why can't you follow us in our religion? No, you can stay your religion. Well, you have to be as malleable as we are. Just one example. There's so many examples now. They say men can get pregnant, I don't know, whatever. All these different concepts that they have out there. And they say you have to conform, you have to conform. And other religions, they may jump right in and conform. So the question is, are we going to simply conform? Or is it that only Islam is holding on and saying, no, we actually stick to our principles? I firmly believe that it is my job to equip everybody with the tools Unfortunately, many people tell me amongst this community, and by the way, not the board members, alhamdulillah, the board members, they let me say what I want to say, mashallah, it's wonderful. So, but no, there are other people that they come up to me, and mashallah, they're well intended. I'm not trying to attack anybody. I know they're well intended. But they say, listen, we don't like when you talk about anything controversial. And my question usually is, okay, which part? What did I say? What part of it is wrong? And the answer is, oh, well, the people that don't like it, they don't actually listen to what you have to say. They just don't like the fact that you talk about certain topics. So it's not even something specific, like, you know, okay, maybe I can work on it. You know, constructive criticism, I'd be happy to address it. No, you just don't like it in general. It's the whole concept. Sometimes the suggestion comes, why can't he be more like Shaykh so-and-so, somebody else? In those instances, please, I ask you to ask that individual, do you even attend Shaykh so-and-so, that other Shaykh? Do you attend his halaqas? Do you go to his classes? Do you watch him online? Because if the answer is no, then essentially what the person is saying is, why can't Shaykh A, who I ignore, be more like Shaykh B, who I also ignore? I mean, subhanAllah, at a certain point, this becomes a little bit ridiculous. But anyway, I digress. Brothers and sisters, if my job is to help you defend your Islam, we have to ask the question, defend from what? It's not as if non-Muslims are going to ask you softball questions. They're not going to ask you easy questions. You're not going to have non-Muslims coming up to you and saying, why is it that your God mandated charity, zakat? And then you can comfortably respond, oh, to take care of the poor. And they say, wow, that's a great answer. Okay, have a nice day. It doesn't work like that. They're going to try to attack specifically anything that you find awkward, embarrassing, difficult, controversial topics. What type of questions? Two types of topics you'll find always get attention. And I mean this universally, whether we're talking about in movies, whether we're talking about when talking about history, whether we're talking about politics, whether we're talking about religion, there are two topics that always get attention. What are they? Sex and violence. Sex and violence. You'll always find that anything that has to do with gender and anything that has to do with violence will get the most attention. And so where are we attacked? No surprise. What are your issues about gender, the way people, the sisters dress, and this and that? Anything that has to do with gender, you'll find that there's the focus. And then, of course, violence when it comes to terror, this, that, warfare, etc. So I believe that in order to help you, to help this community defend yourselves, I must periodically address controversial and uncomfortable topics. Otherwise, what is the alternative? Otherwise, our message is essentially that Islam is a mostly beautiful religion, but there are some uncomfortable parts, and we just ignore those. What is the problem with that message? What is the problem with the message of saying, look, Islam is mostly beautiful, but there are some uncomfortable parts that we just sort of sweep under the rug and ignore? You know what the problem is? If that's the case, then that's treating Islam exactly like every other religion. Every religion has some nice parts, and every religion has some awkward parts. And so, essentially we're saying, we want to be like you. تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ until you follow their path. Look, we have some awkward parts, some right parts, and let's just, you know, leave it at that. The fact of the matter is that we as Muslims, we believe that Islam is unique, in that all of it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None of it is tampered by man. Therefore, since all of it is revelation, all of it is good, and there's nothing that we should be ashamed of. The most common suggestion when it comes to anything controversial is, why don't you just keep controversies to private, small halaqas, just to a small group of people. Don't talk about it in the masses. I want us all to address this. I want us all to think about this. What is the message that we're sending if that's the way we go about things? Doing that would be an admission that there are some aspects of Islam that are for public discussion, and other parts must be privatized. There are certain aspects of Islam that have to be private, because we're what? Embarrassed about it? Do you guys see the subtle implication? There is a message behind the behavior. This leaves us open to attack, like we have some sort of weaknesses, like we have some sort of holes in our defenses. Oh, these topics can only be brought up in private. Think about this, and by the way, this isn't a far-off idea. Think about anybody, let's say a preacher, somebody who just doesn't like Islam, somebody who wants to attack Islam. They show up, well, first of all, they go online. First thing they do is they go online. And they find all the private topics, all the controversial topics. By the way, internet's an open book. It only takes like 5-10 minutes to